Vice President, fellows, guests, thank you very much for the invitation on behalf of myself and Alex Baylis, who is here at the front. But I'm going to do the presentation and we can take questions at the end jointly. Now, I hope you don't think this first image is any reflection on your tea, which is very good. But it just gives me a chance to catch my breath and to acknowledge our funders very warmly one more time, the European Research Council, and also our wonderful team. I'd like to point out the presence today, very welcome presence today, of two key members of our team, Francis Healy and Alistair Barclay. I'd also like to acknowledge the wonderful help we got from a series of teams across Europe, some of which you'll see reflected in the lecture today. If you can read the writing there, it also leads to the reflection that, of course, we're not the first people to engage with questions of time, but we do see ourselves as coming up now with some radical suggestions about this. And the most radical overall message, take-home message today, is that we would see it being both desirable and possible now to take the pre out of prehistory. We've been accustomed to write about remote pasts like the Neolithic and the Copper Age in strict terms, in rather fuzzy, generalizing, and we think depowering sorts of ways. And we would like to help to change that. There has been a tradition of thinking in a more historical way, aligning archaeological interpretation a bit more closely with history. We think that move could be strengthened, and there are signs around just at the moment that in fact it's becoming weakened. And if we seek a better, closer alignment with history, that of course instantly begs the question of what sort of history we might be able to achieve. So, just before the effects of the tea wear off and you sink into a post-tea torpor, let's just look at a couple of slides about these issues. Here, drawing on the work of the American historian John Lewis Gaddis in his very readable book, The Landscape of History. I won't go through all this, you'll be glad to hear, but there are three key things I want to pull out of this slide. Firstly, the importance of narrative, which I'll go on about several times in the course of the lecture. Secondly, even for historians, even for modern historians, the inevitable partiality of their evidence. If we think away from the written word as being the key card in the pack, I think that sets up much greater possibilities for archaeology of various kinds and history of many, many different kinds to be more closely aligned. And thirdly, although this is a complicated issue, Gaddis makes the distinction between an, on the whole, more particularizing discipline in the form of history, contrasted with, on the whole, more generalizing kind of approach found in the social sciences. I would submit that many kinds of archaeology, including what we've been used to call prehistory, have over the past decades been in that latter camp, the generalizing camp. We start and end with generalizations, and it would be a big, and in my view, our view, I'll say my and our interchangeably, I'm not always sure if Alex agrees with me, but she can speak for herself very well at the end. It would be a big disciplinary and welcome shift if we became much more particularizing on the basis of much more detailed narratives in the future. And this lecture is an attempt to give you a sense of how that might be possible. Just briefly also a word about narrative. These are some extracts from the book Time and Narrative by Paul Ricoeur, French commentator, one of the best reflections that I know of about the character of narrative, treating it essentially as emplotment, but always temporally based. And in the second last quote, they're making an important distinction between simple chronology and moving on from mere chronicle to get at history. And his final quote I find very pertinent as well as very moving: narratives of acting and suffering as their theme. This is the province of humans. I want us to concentrate on human actions, decisions, choices, values, beliefs, which for me in the end constitute history. So I'm setting myself very much, and I deliberately use the term I there, setting myself against the so-called post-humanist turn that has become very fashionable in the last few years. When we last spoke here in a few years ago, I can't remember exactly when, it could have been 5 or so years ago, we were at the end, more or less, of our previous project, carried out jointly with Francis Healy, on the date, and lots of others, on the dating and modelling of cause rate enclosures in southern Britain. That story has gone on and has become more refined. What we're proposing here is a hypothetical walk, someone going from the Upper Thames back to visit their continental cousins, with whom they were still closely in touch in the later 37th century Cal BC. Alex can tell you more later if you're interested about the probabilities behind this, but this is a plausible scenario for things that could have been visible in the course of a single walk from the Upper Thames down to the English coast in the decade of the 3630s. And the fact that we're able to talk in those terms as, in inverted commas, prehistorians is, I think, remarkable. We published all that in the two volumes of Gathering Time some years ago. Other evidence has come along since. More enclosures have been discovered, like Lark Hill, and a new one has just come up, which is the image you're seeing down at the bottom at Datchet in the Middle Thames. Alistair Barclay could tell you more about that in the discussion. But if I get the animation right, we can imagine our person or persons walking across the Thames, going past West Kennet, on to Fussell's Lodge, on to Warbarrow, which has now been dated by a Historic England team, and then finally on past Hambledon Hill, where they might have witnessed exciting attacks on the outworks on the Shroton Spur, and then on, leaving all that mayhem behind them, to visit their continental cousins. Now, that theme of enclosures, we continued partly in our next project, but I'm going to leave that as a hanging thread and not talk about them further today, but to draw from our big European project, as you heard in the introduction, The Times of Their Lives, funded by the European Research Council, carried out in 2012 and 2017. And that involved, in a sense, more of the same, more radiocarbon dating and more Bayesian modelling to end up with much more precise date estimates than we would get by just looking at or eyeballing the radiocarbon dates. But this time we were deliberately choosing a rather ambitious scatter of targets, themes, including settlement, recurrent themes, including settlement and monumentality, materiality, and underlying all that, the sociality of the social formations, the social relations of Neolithic and Copper Age communities at various times and places across Europe. And we saw ourselves as deliberately challenging the application of the method to engage with approaches that we hadn't needed or been able to apply in the previous study in southern Britain. And this was a mixture, therefore, of site-based investigations and, to some extent, small regional investigations. We ran two cases, bigger regional investigations, but it wasn't a, it was deliberately not a rerun of gathering time. That could be, that would be a cumulative cooperative effort. It would probably take several research generations to achieve the same sort of coverage, but it could certainly, we think, now be held as a realistic goal for the discipline to work towards. Now, we began as seeing ourselves as refining the very fine chronological edifice of understanding of the chronology, the sequence for the European Neolithic and Copper Age, which goes back over a century more, very, very distinguished contributors to it. But as time went on, we also found ourselves wanting to challenge many of the things that had been taken for granted through repetition often, and especially we found ourselves wanting to challenge the default chronological perspective, which has tended to be that of emphasizing the long term and emphasizing continuity and expecting and finding slow change. So that in drawing out just four of the case studies here, a sort of pre-Brexit tour, going from Vinča just near Belgrade to Olšinjak in southwest Hungary, and moving from the 6th and 5th millennia, and then jumping up to Orkney in the later 4th millennium and into the first half of the 3rd millennium, and then dropping down into the first part of the 3rd millennium in southwest Spain, just outside Sevilla, the great site of Valencia de la Concepción. Want to give you some flavour of what we were doing, but showing how we can get at much more detailed narratives and how those can contribute to this claimed sense of a more, much more historical, particularising approach. And all the time, as we unpick the long term, I don't want to do away with the long term, but as we unpick it, as we can get it down routinely, if we do the right things to the timescales of lifetimes and generations, we find over and over again a much more dynamic, punctuated, and lively past. And we've all been guilty in the past of smearing so many things into a single, rather slow-moving kind of sequence. So that's what this lecture is trying to be all about. So here's the first case study. This takes us to the great famous site, already recognized in the days of Gordon Child, of Vinča Bela Gorda, just outside on the Danube, just outside to the south of Belgrade in Serbia. Wonderful excavations carried out in the first part of the 20th century by Mnoci Vasic, and what remains of, which is a lot, of the great settlement mound or tau, some 8 meters or more of Neolithic deposit, can speak for the long term. It can certainly speak for continuity. It can certainly speak for steady change. It takes its part in a wider context of development of the Neolithic way of life in this part of Europe. It's not the first phase. This is all beginning in the later part of the 6th millennium BC, several centuries after the first beginnings, and in the regional grouping named after this site, the Vinča culture, we see a lot of consolidation, expansion of the areas of settlement, more numbers, more settling down, and other developments of that kind. So in its own right, it's a very interesting target, long used as a key yardstick for the chronology of this part of the European Neolithic sequence. For any British, well, Alistair knows this joke, any British Neolithic pottery specialists, this is not Romano British fineware, this is Vinci pottery. This is Vinci fineware, which makes our own Neolithic pottery often look like dog biscuit, in Alex's immortal phrase. And we were confident, one of the reasons why we took on various attempts, you see various strands of our approach here, was that we felt there was already a demonstration of chronological order here, which had been provided by the correspondence analysis studies of our German colleague from Berlin, Wolfram Scheer. And he and Dusan Boritz had done some preliminary dating. But our first major strand was to raid the Vasich archive for some, as you see, some 80 samples, and successfully date them and put them into a successful age depth model. Alex can tell you later if you're interested about the technicalities of Poisson process. But with a, we think, very respectable amount of, respectively small number of residual and or intrusive samples, that old archive, some of which had been moved around bits of the Balkans during various exciting 20th century episodes on the backs of donkeys and back again to Belgrade, has stood up very well. So archives are key, do the right things. There is a coherent story there about the long term, getting at the shape in more detail than had previously been established of the whole sequence of the tau development. At the bottom here, that's the early Neolithic so-called Starchevo occupation. A lot of what you're going to hear this afternoon is already published in our various papers. I think the only one that's not yet out is the last one that you'll hear. Another strand was to help to date closely the top of the tell, where a lot of the more recent fieldwork had been concentrated in the last few decades, amongst others by the Tasiches, Nicola and Nenad, father and son respectively. And they were finding not just individual houses, but rows of houses and successions of rows of houses, some of which were burnt. So there's very interesting issues there about what burning on considerable scale may actually mean. Is it peaceful? Is it aggressive? Is it ritualized? Many issues which we discussed in an article published in Antiquity. But what I want to concentrate on here is the detail it gives us of the timing of the end of the life of the tell. There's a significant fire. I'm not going to find it without my specs on. But in second, fire one here. And then after probably a 25-year interval, there's another fire two, which is burning down structures which had been, seem to have been in use for a very short period of time, perhaps as little as 15 years. So you can sort of easily fall into paraphrasing Oscar Wilde here. To get one settlement layer burnt down extensively once is careless, and so on and so forth. What's happening here in the circumstances of the ending? Does the pace of these sorts of events accelerate, and is that then contributing to the moment when finally this great settlement mound, which has now been had a history underneath it, literally underneath it, of several centuries, is brought to an end? And just to pull out to the wider context, we know from provisional modelling, but this is very much a task for detailed work in the future, that other tells are beginning to come to an end and be abandoned from about 4,700 onwards. This is coming to an end at Vincher in the 4-5, very end of the 4-5-50s or in the 4-5-40s. Again, we've got things down to this almost decadal scale in this instance. So we can contribute time to the various models that are out there in the literature about the conditions in which this whole great system was coming to an end. Interestingly also, from a comparative point of view, is the near complete agreement between our model on the left for the Tasich work at the top of the tail and the equivalent stratigraphic position using the older Vasich archive. There, provide the punchline, their medians are out by 3 years. So this gives us confidence that we're getting the right sort of answer. And interestingly, this may be the last, one of the last, or perhaps the last of the Vincha culture tells to be abandoned. The final strand here was exploiting a new cutting that was made possible because the part of the tail was about to fall into the Danube here behind Alex, obviously, and our colleague Miroslav Maritz. And the opportunity was taken by our Serbian colleagues to excavate quite a small cutting, but with modern single context recording, very carefully, with now discrimination between burnt and unburnt buildings, which had been missed routinely in the much of the earlier work at the site and other comparable sites. So a much more detailed record, the opportunity to gather lots and lots of samples from house floors, house destruction levels, and so on and so forth. Thanks to ERC funding, we could throw lots of dates at this and model the results in these terms. There's always a fly in the ointment. In this case, it was at the top and the bottom were not so well preserved. But what we're seeing excitingly in the middle of the cake, as it were, is a series of detailed, unprecedentedly detailed estimates of the durations of the individual houses that go to make up the body of the accumulation of the town. And you can see them stacking up in time in the upper part of the graph, and in the lower part, Alex has pulled them out as durations. Your time scale here is 0-50 years. So some seem quite short-lived, some in the middle are unusually longer, but they're still probably not much more in use than half a century. This variation up at the top. And there's an interesting story there about how houses relate to the beginning of the tail, the variation between burnt and unburnt houses and so on, which I won't go into on this occasion. It's all published. Finally, this work at the single site gave us one of the keys into putting proper timescales onto the great Vincha culture sequence, which has been worked on by generations of distinguished colleagues, especially through the analysis, the typological analysis of pottery. And so now we can put a timescale on all the Vincha A, B, C, D schemes and so on. And in another paper, we took that, as it were, sideways and gathered up some 600 not our own dates, but other published dates, to create a kind of regional map of the expansion of the Vincha network. So what we're doing is firstly creating much better timings, but we're also unpicking the long term, and through the lens particularly of an individual site, Vincha Bella Borda, we're able to see much more detail than we could previously about the process of tell accumulation, about the nature of household history, and finally the conditions in which things perhaps accelerated at the end and in the years immediately running up to its final abandonment. And this is a big tipping point across many parts of Europe as a whole, this middle fifth millennium period, things are changing also in the longhouse world. It's a phase when new kinds of enclosure are being built, the rondelle enclosures, and a series of other changes that take us through Central and Western Europe. And perhaps not here, but we can think much more about the connections. There tend to be different research communities that engage with different problems. The Venture lot with the Venture and other phenomena in Southeast Europe. Then there's an LBK crew, and then there's a monuments crew out in the West. And we don't often get together enough. So this kind of work allows that sort of more global approach to become possible within a particularizing, much more historically oriented approach. Our next case study, moving on, takes us into Southwest Hungary, and we're now looking at a site that in broad terms belongs to the first half of the 5th millennium Cal BC. We're in the so-called Lengyel culture. This again, in big terms, represents continuity from the initial settlers represented by the famous LBK culture. So a continuation of house existence, more sites becoming visible in the landscape, perhaps with time more differentiated mortuary practices and more social differentiation, things like that going on. But again, this world doesn't last forever, and it too seems to come to an end in the middle of the fifth millennium. So that's just a very quick thumbnail sketch of the kind of context to which this wonderful site, Olsonyék, apologies for my Hungarian pronunciation, belongs. And this is a recent discovery, thanks to motorway investigations, on a very big scale. North to south, it was well over a kilometre that was investigated. And it has earlier occupation, but it also has a lot of Lengyel, first half of 5th millennium Cal BC occupation. In fact, the site is estimated to be as big as 80 hectares in extent, at least twice, if not more, bigger than any other previously known Lengyel site in this part of the Lengyel distribution. And there's a wonderful rich archaeology of houses and great pit complexes that go with them. The houses scattered around without obvious central buildings. And then a whole series of burials from the excavated slice, some 2,300 or 400 burials from the road slice. Nearly all of them individual burials, men, women, children, grouped around the site in smaller and bigger groups, giving the impression that they're neighborhood cemeteries scattered in and around the different constituent parts of this great settlement complex. So, big site, what would we normally think? Well, we think, oh, well, it's going to have a long history because it's big. That's the kind of way we tended to think, rather crudely put, in the past. And yes, indeed, it does have quite a long history. As you can see here, this is the number of dated features on a generational scale, a generation being defined for the purposes of the argument as 25 years. There it has a respectably long history. But what's particularly striking about Olsonyék, and we published this extensively with our Hungarian colleagues, the team led by Esther Bamfi, is the way that a lot of this activity seems to be concentrated into the early part of the site. It becomes a big site very rapidly on this sort of scale. And then it has a peak as a major coalescence or major aggregation, something of that kind, borrowing terms from the comparative literature, and then tails off quite rapidly to have a long, slow decline. So there's something very interesting. Why is there suddenly this great concentration of people. We don't understand that. There's still a lot of post-excavation, probably years of post-excavation to do, and all sorts of scientific analyses to be done. The Hungarians have been carrying out all sorts of isotopic and ADNA work and so on and so forth. In the comparative literature, one of the conditions in which sites of this kind often form are under troubled times with the push of regional violence. But there's so far, according to the skeletal investigations, no major upsurge in trauma or anything of that kind visible on the human skeletons involved. So we don't know for the time being what is actually causing people to come together in this way, but it seems again to be something important within that envelope of a couple of centuries, just before 4700 through to about 4500, when things are changing and then ending in this part of Europe. We can go further using the dates to make estimates, and we think of a much more reliable and robust, certainly explicit and quantifiable and changeable, if you like, than other kinds of population modelling that are going on at the moment, for example, through rounding up the density of radiocarbon dates, which we think is unreliable. Of course, you have to make assumptions. Some 120 houses were excavated in the road slice. There's an estimate of perhaps 400 or so across the site as a whole. We need to make assumptions about how long a house was in use. We have chosen a figure of perhaps 25 years as a defensible house duration, but we can put in other estimates and you get different results. But with that 25-year figure, it could be that at the peak of occupation, round about 4,700, there could have been as many as 200 houses in use, whereas at the end of the history, maybe just a handful. So we get a much more explicitly quantified sort of measure of numbers of structures, and we can do something comparable with population, because we can extrapolate up to the possible, not from the excavated number of burials to the possible total. We have to normalize them because of missing children from the mortuary record, and then we have to play around with different mortality rates and so on and so forth. And Alex can talk you through this if you're interested. It's published in great detail in the Berichte of the Romish Germanischen Kommission. But again, it gives us an explicit, quantifiable figure, probably for a population at the peak of this site of some low thousands of people coming together for a short period of time, perhaps before social tensions led to the whole thing splintering and becoming much less important. And finally, this even possibility of using these figures to get at the possible size of households, putting number of houses and possible number possible population numbers against the number of houses, and coming up with a household size of perhaps somewhere between 10 and 18, which doesn't compare too badly if you can calculate the same figure using the Rolls method of household constituents being roughly a tenth of floor area. Again, a lot of assumptions going into here, but they're explicit and they're also informative. So again, working closely with our Hungarian colleagues, we were able to not only better time this site, but unpick its history, show that it wasn't just in use for three centuries as a more or less smeared kind of site biography, but that it had an accelerated beginning, a briefly maintained peak, and then a long, slow decline. And that in turn set in the wider regional context a whole series of changes and eventually the disappearance of the Vinča culture and the Lenjel culture and a whole series of transformations usually talked about in terms of the early Copper Age by the regional specialists, but I won't go into that on this occasion. Now, if you're still with me, rather more briefly, last two case studies takes us quickly up to Orkney, where we dated a series of individual sites. One example here is Barnhouse. This is structure two, I think, at Barnhouse, excavated by Colin Richards. And we were able to produce a much more detailed site chronology. The bars here, the numbers of the various individual structures. Is that two there? And a structure, the great building of structure eight, coming slightly later. Earlier time is up at the top on this particular graph, coming slightly later. So this is getting going in the 32nd century and coming to an end in the early part of the, where are we, the 29th century. So a finite existence, quite a long existence in this case, but a finite one. And that's definitely one of the messages that we think also came out of our modelling, which we carried out with Nick Card and his team at the now famous Ness of Brodga site on the mainland, main island of Orkney. This is an unfinished story because they haven't got down to the lower levels yet, and it may take them a rather long time to get there, if ever, but we'll see, live in hope. But this too seems to not be something that was in use for 1,000 years, which was the initial informal estimate of the excavation team, but to have a peak, perhaps roughly of the same order as that of Barnhouse. Now again, and you can follow this in detail in an article published in Antiquity last year, we gathered up other existing radiocarbon dates for the region, and obviously there's a whole heap going on here which I don't have time to talk about, but the sorts of key things that we sought to draw attention to were, again, the constituents of a much more dynamic and punctuated late Neolithic Orkney story. It's not all the same. When you get into the detail, we can see, first of all, a period of overlap between older traditions, round-based pottery, and the innovation of grooved ware, perhaps coming in the 32nd century. Interestingly, stalled cairns and the developed passage graves, the so-called Mace Howe type, may not go back that far in time before that, but are overlapping with this. Big sites are not like Barnhouse and Ness of Brodga are not lasting forever. And if I can find it, yes. Other parts of this landscape, the Ring of Brodga, on the basis of its existing and, as we modelled them, OSL dates, optically stimulated luminescence dates, coming significantly later at a time when its great neighbour, the Ness of Brodga, was probably a place of ghosts being infilled deliberately with midden dumps and generally abandoned. The Ring of Brodga gets inserted into a seemingly much more empty kind of landscape. And this plays out also on a regional scale on the basis of the numbers of dated sites. We think activity drops away in the, as it were, the core of mainland Orkney after the initial flow of it, and then continues rather more episodically and sporadically in the outlying outlying areas, so-called periphery. So again, that's just a brief introduction to what we see again as a much more dynamic, much more punctuated history when we unpick things, get under the skin, as it were, of the long term, and down to the timescales of lifetimes and generations. My last example jumps us down into the southwest of Spain to the end of the fourth millennium and the early part of the third millennium. This drops us into a very different kind of archaeology, so I apologize for the very rapid changes of scenes, but it makes the same sort of point. It also introduces a little bit more explicitly the sociality of some of these communities. Valencia de la Concepción is a very large site or complex with a series of monuments and features which have been excavated in many, many different places or sectors across the small town that it sits largely under. There we are with our Spanish colleagues, led by Leonardo García San Juan. And these pictures just give you an idea of that kind of archaeology, pits and ditches, and often many burials, often of a pretty simple kind, in pits or so-called artificial caves. But there are also notable monuments, the long known and very wonderful La Pastora with its great passageway and stone corbelled roof, and the more recently excavated and recently published Montelirio Tholos tomb with a round chamber and probably a mud vaulted roof and 20 or so very interesting burials in it. Another example, just to illustrate the general nature of this archaeology, comes from an immediately adjacent area or sector, so-called PP4 Montelirio. Here's the lower level, an individual buried with all sorts of exotic things, with flint and rock crystal and ivory, and we know that ivory has been imported in some quantities into this area from North Africa, even from the Eastern Mediterranean, and it's all very impressive. Now, there were many technical challenges in getting enough dates in this kind of environment, but we did our best, and what I want us just to concentrate very briefly as I come to an end is on these two green bars for the two kinds of tholos. And our sample, we have to remember here, is actually very small, so there's another task for Spanish colleagues in the future to get more sites like this dated. But we think against a longer history of use of this complex, there is probably a quite short-lived phase of megalith tholos construction into which the vast majority of these exotic grave goods are being put with people that seem interesting and different. There may be a slightly later phase when the very biggest and most architecturally elaborate stone vaulted tholoi are constructed as a last gasp before beaker practices are introduced into this part of southern Iberia. So we think it's, and our Spanish colleagues think this is part of the story of the emergence of elites with very widespread, far-flung connections who carried out extravagant funerals as part of establishing their social position. But from the chronology, provisional chronology that we were able to establish with them, it looks as though this was not maintained for very long. Maybe the effort of it all was simply something that in the conditions of the Neolithic and the Copper Age that was not sustainable. That's something that I think we see over and over again in the story of the development of the Neolithic before the Bronze Age. There is social differentiation, but it never seems to last for very long. So we can just pass over that. In concluding, I'd just like to note again the importance of the archives. You see here our French colleagues with whom we work closely in a study on the Upper Rhineland, Anthony Denaire on your left and Philippe Lefranc on your right, sorting through excavated material, looking for the right sort of short life material for us to date. And that's just what we were after over and over again. But this is only possible if people keep their archives for long enough across all the countries of Europe, and if modern rescue excavation is also carried out in such a way as to make this kind of search possible. If we misguided and reasons don't do this, we will not be able to achieve the ambitious agenda which I see in front of the discipline in the future. So finally, let's end with this. I've tried to argue for not only the importance not only of a much better timed Neolithic and Copper Age, but as we get under the skin of the long term, getting us down to the much more interesting time scales of lifetimes and generations, where things never seem to stay the same for very long. That leaves hanging questions of what the overall shape of the Neolithic trajectory may be. I've just written a book about this. It's probably very bad practice to put in a shameless plug, but Oxbow have kindly provided you with a pre-publication offer in a leaflet. You can find that on your way out. Sorry, Mr. President, if I'm breaking every protocol of the Antiquaries. So on this sort of basis, I think we can not only offer these much more detailed narratives, but use them to think in a much more particularizing historical kind of way, for me, centered on people. And I hope I've done enough to get you to agree with this wonderful quote from the French analyst historian in conclusion, Lucien Febvre: "The concept of prehistory is one of the most ridiculous that can be imagined." Thank you very much.